All right, everyone. Hello and welcome. I'm Adam Berezin from MSDynamicsWorld.com, and I want to thank you so much for joining us for today's event, Application of Internet of Things for Microsoft Dynamics AX, presented by Alex Anikiev, Dynamics Technical Architect at Microsoft. Alex has actually presented with us in the past several times, and we're very, very excited to have him back here with us today. So to get this event started, please know that we invite you in the audience to add your feedback and ask questions today during our presentation. You can use the Q&A panel that you see to the right of the window to submit questions to your speaker, Alex. The session will actually be recorded and we'll post it online within the next few days. So without further delay, please allow me to welcome our presenter, Alex Anikiev.
Thank you very much, Adam, and thank you for everyone who is joining us this morning or this afternoon. It's morning for me in Redmond, in Washington. So I'm also very excited about this topic, application of Internet of Things in Dynamics AX, and in particular, my example would be focusing on lean manufacturing and using Raspberry Pi as a device, as an IoT device. In the past, like the previous webcast that we did with DynamicsWorld.com was also an IoT topic, and I was focusing mostly on the services side of things, like what services, what IoT services Microsoft provides and how you can make use of them. This time, actually, I'll be focusing largely on the devices piece. So you will, if you attended the previous webcast, you will have a very nice picture of devices and services and how IoT plays its important role for manufacturing and not only manufacturing industry. So I'll just move on, and before I begin, just a quick note of disclaimers about trademarks and copyrights for the companies and their products that I'll mention during this presentation. So this is all listed on this slide. So basically, speaking about IoT and knowing that this is about devices and services, and it has a wide application, broad application in different industries, including manufacturing, services, retail distribution, and public sector, whatever, all the different set of domains and set of industries that Microsoft covers with our ERP and CRM products. So just to kind of narrow this down to how would I approach this topic? How would I investigate and build my scenario for IoT? So what about a domain? What I will be, the discussion will be structured around main pillars, and those are, we'll first discuss the scenario, the practical application of Internet of Things, how we apply in what scenario. Then we'll discuss the device, what exact device we'll be using to implement this scenario. This device will be equipped with a set of sensors. So sensors, you understand from its name, it will allow you to gather some information from the outside, from the external world, and basically collect some data, and device will be equipped with sensors. So we'll discuss what sensors are used, and those sensors, by the way, they have a wide application in industry equipment, which is great for us. The next thing is backend. So it has to be some kind of information system behind. And in our case, it's going to be Microsoft Dynamics AX ERP backend, and all the nice, best in the world in the class lean manufacturing capabilities supplied by Microsoft Dynamics AX. Next one is application. So on the device, we'll have to run some kind of application to communicate with backend and basically control how we collect data through sensors. So we'll discuss what we do there, and the whole story about Windows 10 and Windows 10 IoT Core, which runs on IoT devices and makes amazing scenarios possible. And then we'll end with the references, some of the existing companies using IoT for their benefit, or maybe even wider, using IoT to build their services, IoT services, and provide a service for their customers as well. So very nice reference, I believe, I'll provide to you. And then also from the demonstration perspective and from the practical perspective, we also cover some smaller topics like the connectivity, so just to let you understand how IoT device connects to the network, and then also display, So how do you display what's going on the IoT device and the power supply, and just to understand basically how can you make this scenario, how can you implement this scenario, put this everything you need into your pocket, and then just show up somewhere in front of your customer, take this out of your pocket, put this on the table, and let it go. So that's the idea. The scenario that I will be describing during this webcast will be around manufacturing and lean manufacturing in specifically. So in the context of lean manufacturing, we'll have a work cell worker that will perform some assembly tasks at the designated work cell. And this work cell worker will require a particular part. So what I will be building in this scenario will be motorcycles. And for simplicity, I chose to my motorcycle to consist of two parts. One is the body of the motorcycle, and then two wheels. So very simplistic scenario. And my work cell worker will exactly assemble that motorcycle in his work cell. The water spider is the second role involved. And the water spider, as you know from the lean, or maybe you don't know, but I'll explain from the lean terminology, will be responsible to timely supply required parts for work cell worker to perform his job. So the work cell worker will do the actual assembly. The water spider is a special person who is responsible for performing basically different types of supporting work, the wide range of tasks which allow workers to perform what is called value-added tasks without any distraction. So basically imagine a water spider as a person on the forklift moving parts around from, let's say, supplying locations into work cell locations, so work cell workers can focus solely on performing their jobs. And then in the context of lean manufacturing, of course, this whole process will be controlled by Kanbans. So we will have a process and transfer Kanbans. So transfer Kanbans and associated jobs will be completed by water spider to move parts from supplying locations into work cell or what is called near line side locations. And then the process jobs will be performed by the work cell worker himself to assembly this motorcycle. I will also use a Raspberry Pi IoT device powered by Windows 10 IoT core to basically introduce what I call intelligent location concept. So imagine that at the work cell, there's a location that is capable of basically detecting its state, like whether it's empty or full. And then if it's empty, this means that the work cell worker will not be able to perform this assembly task. So the water spider will have to replenish that location. And all will be controlled with the visual signal. So as you will see, I will use the LED that will light up with the different colors. So when I will show you the physical device. And then, so this intelligent location will, for the sake of simplicity, will detect its state, empty or full, and then this will trigger creation and completion of Kanbans. So that's the whole idea of this scenario. This is how it looks like conceptually on the diagram. So I have a main storage location, I have water spider, maybe with a handheld device, displaying those transfer jobs that he has to complete, transfer jobs associated with the Royal Kanbans. And then there is a part location or near line side location, which is the work cell worker, which work cell worker is working with. And then the work cell worker will retrieve this part, put this on the assembly line, and then the process job will be completed. So as you can see in this scenario, I'm using infrared sensors to detect the state of this location. So if I put some part inside of that location, I have a transmitter, I have a receiver, and when transmitter transmits the signal, receiver will not be able to receive it, which means the location is full, and then appropriate Kanban job will be completed. And then vice versa, if the location is empty, then appropriate transfer job will be generated, and then when this location becomes full, appropriate transfer job for withdrawal Kanban will be completed. So this is what I will show you during the live demo. But this scenario does not stop here. And if you think about more practical example of lean scenario using IoT, you will see that there is it can be more to it. So basically, the second iteration of this scenario, which is, by the way, it's all explained on my blogs with the full level of detail. So if you want, you can do it yourself. You have all the access to all the materials, very detailed, published on my blog. So basically, an advanced lean scenario, more practical use of IoT for lean, you will have a warehouse, and in the warehouse, you will have different bulk locations with inventory. You will have what is called a near line side location, and you will have a line side location. So basically, in this advanced lean scenario, we added WMS as additional almost necessary step for the modern enterprise to move goods from warehouse into near line side location, and then from near line side location, we can move it to the line side location for works or worker to work with. So the first piece, the left-hand side of this diagram, will be handled through Dynamics AX WMS, advanced WMS, with a warehouse worker with a handheld device, with the work generated on handheld device, using the power of IoT, RFIDs, and all that stuff. And the right-hand side of this diagram will be handled by, just like in my core lean scenario, by Kanbans, withdrawal and manufacturing Kanbans, and this is how it works. The distinctive features of this scenario is that actually in the variation number two of this scenario, I went much further. So instead of using infrared transmitter, infrared receiver, in this case, I'm using the weight sensor to determine quantities. So not only it's empty or full, but also like what quantity of the product is being used, and then this will come handy for the recycled Kanbans, for the partial fulfillment of Kanbans and different scenarios. And also I'm using RFID technology. So RFID technology will allow me to handle mixed items locations when I can put some different items in the same location. And then also it may allow me to even determine who is working on that location. So like this RFID may be somebody's badge. And another RFID tag will be dedicated to the product identification. So this is the advanced lean. This scenario is completely built out and available on my blog, so you can replicate it today. And then if you think even more broadly about the enterprise level scenario, you will see that the lean manufacturing may be just a small kind of subset of the big scenario on enterprise scale. So in this case, and this will be published in the next 2 weeks. I'm still working on the enterprise scale scenario. But the idea here is that you can equip your machinery with a set of sensors, as well as your product with a set of sensors. From the pure inside of like your four walls and looking at your machinery, the great example, the classic, I would say, example of application of IoT would be around maintenance. So you can equip your machinery with the sensors. Those are described here on the right side of this slide. And some of the sensors will be purely kind of measuring the state, measuring the health of your equipment, right? So purely IoT type of measurements. But we can also extend this to more OEE application, the overall equipment efficiency, and we can measure availability of that machine, we can measure performance of that machine, we can measure quality metrics of this machine, and we can also add some visual analysis tools through cameras and so on to have a real-time access to for technicians, for production managers to what the state of this machine is. So basically, and this is one thing, and in terms of maintenance, we can break this down into predictive maintenance and preventative maintenance, and I'm also going to use Dynamics CRM Online and Field One Service Management for the preventative maintenance piece, and then predictive maintenance I'm going to implement using Windows Azure Machine Learning. So all the measurements that I will collect, especially in terms of the physical state of the machine, the temperature analysis, vibration analysis, motor analysis for the equipment itself, I can turn into a predictive machine learning service. And then I can tell you, basically based on the previous, based on the past statistics of how this machine ran, we'll be able to tell you when the breakdown will happen and what to do with this and how to prevent this. And then also, like you can connect this with the sales and marketing, more looking from the product perspective. So lean manufacturing will be used in Dynamics AX will be used to produce the product, and then Microsoft Dynamics CRM Online Sales and Marketing will be able to use it to properly sale and produce the sale of this product and then market this product. So this actually, in my opinion, is a very good like a combined scenario that shows you the power of IoT from both fronts, from the manufacturer perspective and from the end consumer perspective, because the product equipped with sensors may send some alerts to Dynamics CRM Online in terms of, again, maybe I need to opportunities for upsell, opportunities to market more parts for that particular end product and so on. So this is, in my opinion, a very good combined scenario which leverages the full power of IoT, and as you can see, the lean manufacturing is just a part of it. So going forward today, I will focus solely on lean manufacturing piece. So once we discuss scenarios, now you will ask, what about the device? So what device can I use to implement this nice scenario? So the device I chose is the Raspberry Pi 2 Model B, powered by Windows 10 IoT Core. So the nice thing about Raspberry Pi IoT devices is that it uses ARM low power processors, just similar to what you find in your smartphones or other devices, and it's capable of doing amazing things. So it's capable of running Windows 10 IoT Core, which is a variation of Windows 10 operating system for IoT devices. And when you power your Raspberry Pi device with the power, just connect this to the power, it will automatically launch Windows 10 IoT Core operating system, which is installed, by the way, on this SD card. So when this happens, you will ask, like, okay, so this is good, this is the operating system, how can I see it? So you can connect your Raspberry Pi device through HDMI port to your monitor, and what you will see, there's a user interface which is displayed right here. So when you just power this on, operating system launches, and then you will see a basic user experience which is presented on the slide here. It will show you what device it's connected to, it shows you the connections, the physical connections this device has, like in this case Ethernet connection, and I can connect even USB keyboard, and I can connect this through a USB Wi-Fi dongle to the wirelessly to my network and so on, and you can do some basic management tasks on this using this user interface for the operating system. So this is about the device. The second interesting piece about the device is basically to explain you what interfaces this device supports. So on this slide, I have a pinout of Raspberry Pi device displayed. And what you can see, there are multiple pins. And I'll just briefly explain to you, assuming that some of you may have this knowledge already, some of you may not. So I'll just very briefly go through this. So you can see different colors for those pins. And some of them are obvious and trivial, like a power. So you connect to that pin to get the power. And then the ground pin, also obvious by its explanation. And then there are three main interfaces that Raspberry Pi device supports. So one is called GPIO, the General Purpose Input-Output. So all it does, and I'll probably hold on with the explanation because next slide will explain even better. So GPIO, SPI, which stands for Serial Peripheral Interface, and I2C, which stands for Integrated Circuit. So GPIO is the most easy one to work with, so I'll explain all of that on the next slide. SPI and I2C is kind of similar by purpose. So with SPI, it has more pins than I2C. I2C just allows you to communicate through two pins for the data interaction. And the serial peripheral interface is meant for basically the main data is communicated through three pins. And it's meant for more like a high-speed peripheral, so high-speed sensors. I2C is meant for lower speed sensors, for lower speed data communication. And then also there is a one wire interface, which you probably will find in some of the industrial sensors. So one wire has just a one pin for communicating data. So in SPI at least three, in I2C it's two, and in one wire it's one. So one wire interface is not directly supported through Raspberry Pi device, But you can support this through a connector. So you can transform one wire signal into I2C interface, and there are connectors that you connect and transform the signal to I2C, and this is how you can do it. And I actually in one instance of the sensor, I had to do that. So it supported for the temperature, it supported one wire interface, and I had to connect it through basically a transformer, a connector, to transform that signal into I2C interface. So just so you know, there are multiple interfaces supported, and those pins by their names, you will see that some of them will start with GPIO, that corresponds to GPIO. Some of them will start with SPI. So SPI supports two clients, as you can see, SPI1 and SPI2 at the same time, two slaves, what it's called. And then there is one I2C interface and two ports on that, SDA and SCL. So without too much details, how do we make use of those interfaces? Under Windows 10 IoT Core Operating System and using Visual Studio 2015, there are namespaces directly dedicated for those interfaces. So one is called windows.devices.gpio. So it's a very easy way to instantiate instance and connect to GPIO pins. And then basically on GPIO, what you do, you just measure a level of signal on GPIO pin. It's either 1 or 0, like high or low. And then depending on how this pin and how the signal is sent to that pin and how for what length of the time this signal will remain high or will remain low. So different sensors will work different way. But the whole idea of GPIO is that you can measure high or low level of the signal on GPIO pin. And this pin can be input or output. So very easy concept. And sometimes it's a little bit more cumbersome because you have to physically deal with the time intervals and measure the level of the signal within the time period and then do something with it. And typically you will look into the spec of the sensor itself to get some insight about how when you measure the outcome, how do you make sense of it. So then the serial peripheral interface and inter-integrated circuit interfaces, think about more as electric circuits and like a chips that will have resistors, transistors, that will have registers. Those registers will store physical data. So it's like a mini integrated schema that you have on hand, and then you can write data into that small chip, or you can read data from this chip. So it's more intelligence embedded on board. So that's why, and there's a small explanation about this, and I provided the difference between SPI and I2C in terms of high-speed devices, high-speed peripherals, low-speed peripherals, and different number of pins used for that. And actually, if you need the ultimate level of details about how I implemented this for my scenario, you can refer to my blog, and you'll find all of that there. So specific sensors that I used in my example that I will demonstrate. I used infrared transmitter and receiver. So the physical principle is that transmitter will transmit signal across the location, and if receiver is able to receive that signal on the other end, this means the location is empty. If the signal disappeared on its way, that means that it got reflected from the physical part which is in that location, which means that the location is full. And then there are variations in terms of how you can use infrared transmitter, infrared receiver separately, or you can use this on the one board, which is called obstacle avoidance sensors, a sensor, and there's a different physical principle being applied in two instances. For the advanced scenario, I actually used this set of sensors. So I used RFID RC522, which is the industrial, almost like industrial standard for RFID devices, and then there are two tags supported, right? So there's a round tag, which I used for the product definition and product determination, and there is a more like a badge-like rectangular tag, which I used for determination of the employee based on almost like his badge. So it's you have to position your tag next to this reader, and this reader will communicate details of what tag was in front of that reader back to IoT device, which is the Raspberry Pi. For the weight sensor, actually, I had to apply, I had to basically make use of a load cell and an amplifier, transforming analog signal from the load cell. So again, because of for the sake of the time, I will not explain the physical principle of how load cell works. But load cell generates the analog signal, which has to be transformed into a digital signal. So that's why I use this amplifier and transformer from analog to digital. And again, all is described on my blog. And those two are meant to be used for the weight definition. And then for the enterprise scenario, I use this set of sensors. As you can see, there is a temperature sensor, which actually supplies data through one wire interface. So this is why I needed this transformer from one wire to 1-2C. And then there is a shock sensor, which measures the vibration. There is a nice spring inside, which if you apply vibration and this sensor is on the side of your machinery, it will start, the spring will start shaking, and this basically connects the electric circuit, and this is how I can measure the level, how many and how much vibration is applied on the machinery. And I use some other sensors, including the color sensor, to measure basically more for the quality. Like if I'm supposed to be producing red items or red painted bodies for my motorcycle, and for some reason one of the bodies was painted into green, I can basically detect this, and I can detect the violation of the quality or generate the rejection. So for this purpose, I can use color sensor. So then we approach in a live demo, and before I do that, I'll explain you the physical, kind of the physics of the process and experiment I implemented. So I use three sensors in this particular example. One sensor is infrared transmitter, another one is infrared receiver, and plus the LED, which lights up with blue, green, or red light. And this is the principle of how it works. If I would use transmitter and receiver separately, of course, there is an overhead of basically controlling those sensors separately, right? So I have to first send the impulse from transmitter, and then within the time frame allotted for receiving that time, this impulse sent by transmitter, receiver has to be able to receive it. And based on the specs of infrared receiver, I determined the time T, which is allotted for the impulse to be transmitted across the location. And then within that time frame, it's like a very, very small time frame. It's like within ticks of the processor. I'll be able either to receive it or not to receive it. And basically, if this, if I have a product in this location, the signal and impulse will be reflected and the receiver will not receive it. So basically, this is the physical principle of how I determine whether a location is full or empty. And if I'm using obstacle detection sensor, which has receiver and transmitter on the same board, this is this part of the slide, and it's already synchronized. So basically, when transmitter is transmitting signal, based on reflection principle, receiver knows when to receive it. So I don't need to program them separately. That's the benefit of using obstacle detection sensor. In this case, this is the physical principle of how it works. And then I have to, in C#.NET code, I have to basically parse out the results and then make determination whether its location is empty or full. The little bit complication, a little bit disadvantage of using this type of sensor in this scenario is that I cannot effectively determine the initial state, because you have to literally move your part in front of this obstacle detection sensor to let it kind of determine or let it receive some signal. So that's why I eventually went with this approach. A little bit more work, but it's much more robust and much more flexible. So by the way, the obstacle detection sensor is great for counting scenarios. When you have a conveyor belt and something rolls on the conveyor belt next to or by that obstacle detection sensor, and it detects how many products you produced and so on. And by the way, I'm using this in my enterprise scenario exactly for counting purposes. So I think at this point, we are ready to see the actual demo, and I'll just very quickly go through a couple of slides The application that I used, I built Windows 10 IoT Core background app that runs on a Raspberry Pi device itself. You can also build a typical Windows 10 Universal apps, which will run even with the user interface, so you can see if you connect this to your monitor, external monitor through HDMI cable, you will see even the user interface. You may have it easily. But for the industrial scenarios, of course, you will likely have a background apps running on the Raspberry Pi itself, Pi device itself, and then communicating with backend through web services. That's the idea here. Very easy to do, and the benefits that you can realize the full benefits of Windows 10 platform for all the different variety of devices, including IoT, Raspberry Pi. The backend, I used Microsoft Dynamics AX2012. Sorry for the typo. It's supposed to say AX2012 R3. And then also Microsoft Dynamics CRM Online. So the connection from the Raspberry Pi device and from that background app is through web services, and it's very easy to add a reference to your web servers into your Visual Studio 2015 project, and then the Raspberry Pi device is capable of invoking web services very easily, and of course you have to make sure that it's a secure connection and provide all of that, but for the sake of simplicity, I just exposed publicly those endpoints. And in a real enterprise architecture, the public exposure of web services will be very highly insecure. So you will leverage something which is called a Windows Azure IoT Hub, which supports the secure and provides a secure communication platform from external applications or the backend hosted maybe in the cloud, maybe on premises, maybe in a hybrid model, all the way to your device. So that's the Windows Azure IoT Hub and its Dynamics flavor. You will be able to leverage this for the enterprise scenarios. For my case, just for the sake of simplicity, it's a publicly exposed endpoint based on Dynamics AX 2012 R3 instance, which is deployed in Microsoft Azure Cloud as infrastructure as a service using lifecycle services. A lot of acronyms. So at this point, I will switch to the live demo, and then we'll cover the rest of the demonstration style topics. So I will do, give me one second, I'll a little bit relocate to a different spot here, and we'll share my screen. Let's do that. And then I will basically go here. So hopefully you guys can still see my screen. So what I will do, I'll just invoke the camera to display this, which is my table. Okay, excellent. So don't worry, I will reposition my camera so you can see exactly what's going on. So basically, this is my setup. This is for the simplistic core IoT scenario. So what I have here is, I'll just move this closer. What I have here, I have this LED, right, which will display the status of this location, whether it's empty or full. If it's empty, it's going to be red. If it's full, it's going to be green. Then I have those sensors, right? So one sensor is infrared transmitter. Another sensor is infrared receiver. And this is my location, right? So in here, I'll be able to place my part, and then the location itself will determine its state. And then you will see basically a scenario that I implemented is fully automated. So I will first generate those Kanban jobs inside of Dynamics AX, and then I will execute and I will complete those Kanban jobs using my IoT device. So the idea is that if I place something in here, the location will be able to, and this is one of the wheels that will be required for my motorcycle production. The location will determine its state. It will call the web service back to Dynamics AX and will complete appropriate Kanban. So all your work cell worker and water spider will have to focus on will be solely doing work, right? So all the rest will be done for them automatically using Raspberry Pi device, web service call, and then all the automation will happen automatically. So that's the idea. Also, as you can see, I have a little monitor connected to this Raspberry Pi device. So this is, I can see the general user interface of the Windows 10 IoT Core, and then I also have the small, much smaller laptop which runs Windows 10 and Visual Studio 2015. So this is, I will basically launch my app from that laptop, from under Windows 10, and this will launch this app on the Raspberry Pi device. So before I do that, we'll just do a couple of things in AX. So first of all, I will go to my cockpit that I built. It's called Alex Lean IoT Demo. And from this cockpit, I'll be able to introduce, just for the demo, it would be nice to introduce sales order and the demand right away, and then plan the entire pagan tree. Basically, the associated Kanbans will be generated based on Kanban rules, and the plan the whole pagan tree to plan the process Kanban and do all the preparation work. So let's just see what happens. So basically, by clicking on sales order button, hopefully it all will work. What will happen here, my sales order will be generated, my all the associated Kanbans will be generated too, and then the entire pagan tree will be planned. So just in a second, I hope, my sales order will be generated, everything which get us ready for the scenario will be done. So as you can see, my sales order has been generated, so we in a pure make-to-order a pool scenario. So as you can see, that sales order has been generated, and then the Kanban for motorcycle, for the process job, for assembly was planned appropriately. So what I can do, I can now switch to my sales order. And then I will go and display the pagan tree for that sales order. We're still in in preparation mode for the actual IoT operations. And actual IoT operations will take maybe less than a minute because it's just fully automated. So basically, this is my sales order, and what I will do, I will go and view the pagan tree. So I'm not showing you all the details of the BOM structures and all the production floors that I built and all the Kanban rules, because this is all like, this is the end product of it, right? So I have a sales line, I have a Kanban to produce this, to support production of this assembly. Then subsequently I have an issue for the body, which is one of the parts. I have another issue for the wheel in quantity of two, and then actually for the simplicity, quantity of two, yep. And then this issue by itself for the wheel is supported by withdrawal Kanban, because I need to replenish, as you remember from the diagram, I need to replenish from my nearline side location into sideline location. And this is another issue for basically do the replenishment work. So what will happen right now, you see that the job status for transfer job is not planned, and the job status for the process job is planned. So what will happen right now? I will go and I will start my scenario, basically launch my app, and this will show you that, let me do that, just one sec, I'll reach out to my laptop and make sure that everything is in a good shape. Yep, cool. So I'm launching this app right now. So what you will see, this LED will surely light up with the red, because it's supposed to, yeah? One sec. So I have to relaunch it again. Apologize for that. So basically, the whole idea here is that this transmitter will have to send a signal which receiver is capable of receiving, and somehow the calibration will need to be done. All right, so let's try again. Hopefully this time it will be successful. Somehow, I apologize for that, my receiver is not receiving the signal. Okay, now it's Now it's receiving a signal. Okay, now. Okay, excellent. Yes, we'll have to position this properly. Okay. One more attempt. So, of course, in your industrial scenario, of course, this the sensors will be placed appropriately. And okay, now you see that there's a small blinking light here, which means that transmitter is capable of receiving the signal within the time allotted for that. And then you can see also that this light is lit up with red, which means that the location is empty. All right, so one more thing before we proceed. I'll just make sure that my jobs are in the right shape. So for this purpose, again, for those of you who will try to implement this scenario yourself, you will find out that I also built a temporary table which shows you the state of the jobs. So this is for kind of simplicity of operations, right? So process completed, transfer completed. Not yet completed. That's exactly what I need. So basically at this point, what I will do, hopefully you can still see my screen here. What I will do, I will place my product. So I will play first the role of a water spider. So water spider sees the light is red. I have to replenish that location. I have a transfer job for my Kanban here, right? Transfer job for replenishment. So I will place that product into the location. So what will happen is, now as you can see, this light has lit up with green, which means that the location is full. So the transmitter, the receiver is no longer capable of receiving signal from transmitter because it's the part is there. So also the web service call took place, and now we can review what's going on with inside AX, and we can see, we'll be able to see that for this guy, for the transfer job, I'll be able to see that my Kanban job is completed. Okay, I could see it already. So you can see the status is completed, and also that staging table was updated too. So if you want to just solely monitor the progress of your demo, you can also see that it has been marked in the staging table too. So all the full automation here. And then what happens next is I will basically remove that as a workflow worker. I see that the light is green, so the location is full. I can come to the location. I can take this product away from the location. And then suddenly, you will see the light is red again, which means that I just picked that part from that location for the assembly work. So what also happened is another web service call took place to basically complete that process job. So now if I go here and if I refresh this, you will see that the job status for my Kanban for process is completed too. And if I review that Kanban and associated process job, it's completed. So what we were able to do during this scenario, we were able to work in a purely make-to-order situation when sales order has been generated. All the Kanbans based on automated Kanban rules were appropriately created. Then what we could do, we could, using the visual signals, we could display and indicate for the workshop worker and the water spider what to do. And those people would have, on let's say, the water spider on his surface, mounted on his forklift or on his handheld device, he would have the visibility into what Kanbans he has to complete to support workshop worker, and the workshop worker would see all the process jobs required for him to complete. And then basically, completely guided by visual signals, we could replenish location, we could pick from the location and complete all the Kanbans. So now you have the whole track of record of not only the lean manufacturing allows you, guided you to what to do, but also now with the full automation using IoT device, all those Kanban jobs have been completed, so people did not touch their informational systems to like spend time on entering the data. And then also you have a full track of record, who did what, when what was created, and so on. And then now we can basically proceed with a sales order fulfillment, because my product was completed, and now I have this motorcycle which I can ship to my customer. So at this point, I will ask Adam for a small trick to revoke rights and then re-grant the presenter rights for me so I can continue the presentation. Adam, can you please do that?
Sure, my pleasure.
Excellent. So 1 second, and I will move back to my regular spot here.
All right, you should be all set now.
Excellent. So let me share my screen again. And we should be back to the slides, right?
Correct.
Can you guys see the slides? Adam, can you please confirm? I hope so.
I can see them. Yeah. Okay.
Excellent. Cool. Thank you, guys. So basically, I showed you just a small piece, and I'm very excited about this scenario because it shows you end to end with a almost like kind of hands-free experience. You have what you have to do on your device. You do it, and the system just does it for you, right? So a very very minimal kind of intervention. So lean manufacturing in AX just is used in a way kind of amazing, in an amazing way, and I'm really excited about this. But this is just a one subset, and you can find explanation about how I implemented RFID, weight sensor, and all the enterprise level sensors on my blog. I'll refer to this at the end of this presentation. But just to get you guys some understanding about what you can do today, which is quite amazing as for me. So a couple of more things before I wrap up for today. From the pure demonstration perspective, how do we connect my IoT device to the network? So I have a Ethernet connection, as you could see when I was presenting my table. You could see that I connected actually through the Wi-Fi dongle and the Ethernet. And just for the sake of this demo, I wanted to be kind of 200% sure that my IoT device is connected. I'll be able to involve those web services calls to Dynamics AX. But technically, you can have just a Wi-Fi connection through a Wi-Fi dongle. So a little bit of a gotcha here. There's a EDI Max adapter that typically comes with the Raspberry Pi sets, which is not currently supported with the Windows 10 IoT core. So please, if you want to use Wi-Fi, please use the official Raspberry Pi USB Wi-Fi dongle, which does work. And that's just my piece of advice. But you can imagine this device to be mounted on the side of your machine or in the location. And again, the cord length may be anything you want, and then you can put those sensors in the way you want. And the Raspberry Pi will just control all of that, connected to the network through a wired connection or through Wi-Fi connection. Then a couple of more pieces here. So the power supply for the demo, I found useful to use a portable USB power adapter. As you can see, this is what I have one on my table. But it's up to you. You can connect this if there is a stable power, the standard 5 volts micro USB power supply, which connects to the electric outlet. But if you need something more portable, you can put in your into your pocket and still have. Imagine you can have a portable USB power adapter powering your Raspberry Pi device plus Wi-Fi dongle. So you can be holding this Raspberry Pi device in your hand and still will be able to communicate with the backend Dynamics AX and send web services calls. So quite fascinating. And then HDMI port is supplied to display what's going on. And then two modes of operation, two types of apps, as I mentioned before. One is app with the user interface. This is typical Windows 10 universal apps that you built with the UI. This will apply. And then another one, which I used, is the background app, which this is technically called the headless app. And also, I launched this from my laptop, but typically and technically, you will load this app upfront, deploy this app upfront onto your a Windows 10 IoT core on SD card in your Raspberry Pi device. And under Windows 10, there's a small but very useful app which is called Windows 10 IoT device or Windows 10 IoT Core Watcher that shows you every IoT device on the network. And then you can basically, through an easy interface from there, you connect to it and launch any app. So you don't even need a laptop with the app on it. You can just deploy this app directly on the Raspberry Pi and then just using a web browser, launch that app. Or launch that app when you power your Raspberry Pi device on. So very a lot of options, and I showed you probably the most kind of the easy one. And then in terms of references, you will ask like, okay, so this IoT is great, you can do great things, but is there anybody out there doing this work right now? And a good reference that I found is the German manufacturer, the Bosch company. And they basically link workers to ports and stations and using RFID, Bluetooth technologies, and doing very interesting things. And you can, by going through this RFIDjournal.com link, you can find out more about what Bosch is doing. What's in particular interesting about this scenario is that they package this as their IP, and they are not only using it for their benefits, but also made this into a solution that they provide for their customers. So they become an IoT services provider. So very, very cool application of IoT, and you can learn more. And Bosch is one of the leading companies in the world in terms of adopting a new emerging technologies and making a great use of them. And I think you can go to my blog and review all the work that I've done. And I typically do, I typically spend time explaining in details what I've done, and this allows you to, using those resources, allows you to implement absolutely the same thing as I showed you today on your table. So please feel free, and you're welcome to do that. All you have all the assets and all the things. And that enterprise scenario has not been published yet. This will be available on my blog. And that, just in ending, I will a word of credits and appreciation for people who contributed ideas to make this work possible. So Denberg, Steve Moses, two manufacturing experts at Microsoft, my colleagues, Jack Moran, everybody knows Jack, manufacturing thought leader at Sikich. Very special thank you goes to Phil Coy. He is a distinguished, very well-known lean transformation guru at MCA Connect, contributed a lot of ideas, participated in this whole work. And then you guys probably heard about MCA Connect Iridium product, which is the lean modeling software, which very nicely complements, in my opinion, best in class, best in the world, Dynamics AX lean manufacturing capabilities with the best in class lean modeling software from MCA Connect called Iridium. So if you want, you can check this out. And then also I'll mention that there are also people always contributing ideas and collaborating with me, and they basically define where the product is going, like they are part of the product team at Microsoft or Dynamics AX, Corin Volkman and Corin Mason. So very great thank you goes to them as well. So with this, I'll finish, and we'll get into Q&A.
Great, thanks Alex. Looks like we have a couple of questions that have come in. So why don't I read them off to you. This was actually
So because you fixed that problem for me with the panel, so I can actually take care of this myself.
Oh, you can? Oh, okay, perfect. Yep. Okay, excellent.
All right, so let's see. So I will first see the, I see some questions in just, okay, so Bjorn is asking, is this single sensor scenario multi-sensor? So it's a multi-sensor, single sensor. I refer to it in my documentation using obstacle detection sensor, multi-sensor when I separated receiver and transmitter. So what I showed you is a multi-sensor. I'm using LDR sensors. Not sure what the LDR is. So if you, Bjorn, if you can write into the Q&A panel what LDR means, I'll explain, hopefully. Then, previous slide, security warning. surely web services calls into IoT. So yeah, so basically the idea of so Joy is asking like the web services calls into out of AX does not constitute IoT. So the idea of IoT is having devices and services and interconnections between devices and using services. So I think it's a good example of how treating AX as a service and treating Raspberry Pi as a device, how we can establish this connection between device and service. So I think it's, if you attended my previous webcast, when I solely focused on services and Dynamics AX and Windows Azure and the Power BI and the ML, big data, other things. So I think this will make more sense to you. So this is what I would say. Then could you use the same sensors in real environments, the bigger ones? Yeah, you could. So these sensors that I'm using, actually the principle is that I'm trying to pick the ones which will describe the most kind of the all the different interfaces that you can face with in the real environments. And you will find that in one way or other, like just exactly that I'm using, or maybe in the combination of like on the bigger boards, these sensors are used in industrial IoT scenarios. So my answer is yes. Caterpillar has used these technologies extensively throughout their fuel systems division. That's, yeah, it's a good to hear. So I see more and more uptake on IoT, and it's again with the enterprise level architecture using Windows Azure IoT Hub. So this allows you for performance, security, and it's great to hear more examples of this. I would also, Matthew, I would also suggest stressing the ability to data capture for load traceability, huge raw impact and warranty issues. It's a great topic again. It's if we communicate us back to Dynamics AX, Dynamics AX is supposed to have all the information about this, and then again you can apply this in a warranty claim, verification, warranty, all that stuff. Do you have experience with Raspberry Pi and true manufacturing processes? So I have not applied this in a real customer yet. I'll be glad to, and as soon as I do this, I'll share my experience. Very interesting information, integrate IoT administrative systems in the company, then is Bosch using Dynamics on the back end? I cannot confirm that, so for Bernd, I can investigate what exact systems will be in use, but just in terms of sensor usage, it's a great application of sensors, RFID and other things. If you wish the high capabilities of Office 365 to bring the need for MSDS references, lockout, tagout, procedures, relationship, preventive predictive maintenance. I'll be glad to incorporate this into my enterprise scenario. Great idea. So Matthew, thank you for, probably I will include you in credits for the next one. okay, sensors, how can we watch this other presentation? If you refer to like the other scenarios, we can speak with Jason, Adam, and Laura at dynamicsworld.com, and I can do a follow-up and show you the other one. I'll be glad to. We'll just find a way. What triggered the program to begin checking the location? Great question. So, Thad, this means that you really paid attention. So, basically, my initial idea, what I did, actually my initial state by definition, so I'm looking for the empty state. This is my assumption. And then as soon as empty state changes to a full state, this means that the first part of the scenario has been completed with the water spider replenishing the location. And then basically my assumption is the location is empty at the beginning. But I can tell you with using two sensors, receiver and transmitter separately, I can tell you what state of location this location is right now. But assumption is it's empty, and as soon as I change from empty to full, this begins the scenario. So this is to answer your question. But you can implement this technically. You can say I will officially launch something, or like I mean, if you have an app with the UI, with the user interface, you can implement the button and say start, and then this will start listening. In my case, it was just kind of with assumption of empty location at the beginning. Does the Raspberry Pi have advantages over Spark Core, which seems to be a similar device? It's up to you what to use. My preference was to, basically for Raspberry Pi to be supported by Windows 10 IoT Core and in Visual Studio 2015. So a Spark Core device is not listed there. There's a Raspberry Pi and Mino board which are listed there, and some kind of indirectly Arduino. So I did not see Spark Core device there. If you can make a Windows 10 IoT Core running on Spark Core device, you're welcome to use that one. But if you can't, you will have to switch to one of the devices which supports Windows 10 IoT Core. So that's just to answer your question, Pete. Let's see. Couple of questions in my Q&A bucket here, Shirley Webster. Okay, so I think I answered that. So I think we're good. So I answered everything which is there. If you guys have any more questions, you're welcome to post them now. We're a little bit over time. And if you want to reach out for the advice or for the direction, if you want to start using my materials posted on my blogs, I'll be grateful if you do that. And then we can think about doing the follow-up session when I can show you the advanced one, maybe with the more demo, because you saw the principles, and I can do more demo time. I think that's it, Adam.
Great.
Thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Alex. That was excellent. Thank you very much. And thank you, everyone, for attending. Really appreciate you taking the time out of your busy day to attend our session. As I mentioned at the beginning, this session was recorded, and we'll post it online within the next couple of days, and we will make sure to email each and every one of you with a link to the recorded session. So thanks again, and have a great rest of the day. Bye-bye.
Goodbye.